weeks ago, our United States Supreme Court legalized gay marriage. And coupled with that, we have a lot of issues going on in our society right now that has led the leadership of this church to decide to let you know as a church where we stand on these topics. This isn't going to be an easy message to give. It's not going to be an easy message to receive. So, I will be talking about the gay rights movement, and I'll be talking about homosexuality. And just that word makes some of us very nervous. The topic evokes all sorts of emotions, from fear, confusion, despair, anger, hatred, and sorrow. And I don't like to focus on just one sin because by doing so, it can elevate it above all other sins. But let's be clear from the start what it means to address such a hot potato topic as homosexuality. We may be a peaceful people. We may not want to offend anyone. And we don't want to unnecessarily make waves. But it is impossible to take a position on homosexuality without being controversial. So, why should we go there? I mean, who needs it? Life is too short to fight, right? Controversy, for its own sake, is sin. But controversy for the sake of truth is a divine mandate. And so then, there are times that the body of Christ needs to, or has a divine mandate to be controversial for the sake of truth. So, should we address this issue? Yes. The question is, how then should we address this issue? Because it's not enough to be controversial. It is absolutely crucial, even when we're controversial, we are Christ-like. I like the way that Paul puts it in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. You know, that word workmanship came from the Greek word poema, from which we get our word poem. So let me read that again to you. We are God's poem. And just like a poet tries to express their heart and mind through their poetry, God wants to express His heart and His mind through us, His visible representation on earth. So our challenge is not just to simply respond to the gay rights movement, but rather to respond effectively as God's earthly representatives. If we wish, as the body of Christ, to respond effectively to this difficult issue, I think our best response will include repentance through self-examination and recommitment in three areas that I want to address with you this morning. First of all, if the church is going to respond in an effective manner, the church must repent of whatever moral compromise may exist within our own walls and recommit to biblical standards of holiness. And when I say church, that means every individual member. Most of you are familiar with the Old Testament story of Samson. He was buff, he was strong, and he was authoritative. And the interesting point about his strength, though, was that he was strong not because of his muscle, but because he was under a vow not to cut his hair. And as long as he retained his vow with God, he retained his strength. And it was only when he allowed his hair to be cut and thereby compromised his vow that he lost his strength. Now, I, for one, refuse to believe that you have to have a full set of hair to be powerful. I'm pretty sure it's like that. But what was true of a man is also true of the church as well. If we as a people wish to have an impact on our culture, let's remember this. Compromised holiness always means compromised impact. And we can't have impact without self-examination. In his book entitled Boiling Point, author and pollster George Barna wrote, "Christians fail to transform our culture because they are neither grieved by nor are they humbled by their own sin." Biblical standards of holiness include honesty and accountability. If we're going to be truly a holy people, let's admit how hard it's going to be in these sexually idolatrous times to be truly holy, and how much we need to lean on Jesus and others around us. Now, my job requires me to travel some, and sometimes I stop at a restaurant that has a bar. I've watched the regulars come in and sit down with their friends and drink, and I can remember thinking, oh, how boring. These folks must have nothing better to do in the middle of the day than to drink together. But as I continue to observe this scene over and over again in different eating establishments, I've noticed something these folks have that I have come to envy. And that's their easy way with each other. They walk through the door of the bar, they look at each other, and they say, "Oh, thank God, it's just you. Life's driving me crazy. I'm mad at the kids. The wife is a nag. I hate my boss. I'm in a grumpy mood. But at least with you, I can be myself. I can be vulnerable. I can be authentic." You know, sometimes I've asked myself, why can't the body of believers be more like a bar? At least in some ways. Isn't it a sign of grace working among us when we can come into this place of worship and honestly look at each other and say, "Oh, thank God, it's just you." All week long, I've been conflicted, tempted, dealing with an awful boss, an unreasonable clientele. The pressures are tremendous, but here in this house, I can admit my temptations and struggles. Not so I'm given permission to sin, but rather so I can be given the accountability and encouragement that I need so I won't sin. Having done that, we have locked into the principle that the Hebrews writer talked about in chapter 3, verse 13, when he said, "But encourage one another daily, as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness." So then, how can we be affected to this issue of homosexuality? First of all, we must be consistent. More to the point, if today you recognize there is an ongoing moral compromise in your life, whatever it is, please know this. The greatest blow you can strike against sexual immorality in our culture today is to be a separated, holy person yourself. So please, if there is unconfessed sin in your life today, bring it to light. Confess it and forsake it. That's the first step. We must be a people who are consistent with the principles that we preach. Number two, the church must repent of hostility toward homosexual people and recommit to bold love. To whatever hostility exists within our ranks, we must repent of that and recommit ourselves to bold love. First of all, I want to look at the difference between anger and hostility. I believe that many Christian people today are angry about the progress of the gay rights movement in America. And I believe that anger is a righteous anger. And I believe that it's necessary. Some of the best social movements in our history started because people got collectively angry about something, and then they did something redemptive about it. That is righteous anger, and of that, I do not feel we need to repent. Righteous anger corrects a problem. Not so with wrath. When I feel wrath, I don't want to correct. I want to strike out. I want to hurt or kill. And that's why James said in chapter 1, verse 20, For man's anger does not bring about the righteous life that God desires. You know, it's one thing to be angry about another person's sin and the impact it's having on your family, on your church, or your community. But it's another thing to feel genuine hostility towards that person. That is the wrath of man. Hostility sometimes shows itself in what I call the Jonah syndrome. You know, Jonah was an amazing prophet. And he received a calling from God to go visit and preach to a people that he absolutely hated, the Ninevites. The Ninevites were wicked, they were violent, and they were a very unattractive people to him. And so Jonah went to great lengths to get out of that assignment. But as you know the story, God went to even greater lengths to bring him back. And finally, Jonah himself was vomited out of a fish's mouth and found himself on a beach. And as he was, I picture, wiping that slime off his body, he said, "All right, I'm right already. I'll go." But according to the account in the Bible, even after God had saved him from this 3-day cruise in the belly of a fish, Jonah still had a bad attitude toward the Ninevites. He went out and preached to the Ninevites, and I think this may have been the worst evangelistic sermon ever. He said, "Destruction's coming. You're going to die. You're going to burn. Good night." And then, that was it, because he gave no call to repent. He gave no visitor card. He gave no follow-up. In fact, he got himself a front row seat, and he sat there on the edge of his seat waiting for the barbecue, because he knew God was going to come down and fry these wicked people. And he couldn't stand them, and he wanted to see it. Then wonder of all wonders, even after that awful, awful sermon, all of Nineveh repeated, all the way from the king on down. And do you think Jonah was happy? Not on your life. He went ballistic. And he said, "God, that was sneaky. I came and I preached judgment against these sinners. And look what you did. You saved them." Jonah was more interested in the destruction of the people he opposed than interested in seeing their redemption. And I ask that question then. How many of us are afflicted with the Jonah syndrome? When the people that we oppose lose their humanity in our sight, when they stop being our co-citizens, our co-workers, our family members, our friends, and they just become them, the others, those people, that agenda. I believe they lose their humanity in our sight. We lose a sense of value of their souls, and we too sometimes can fall prey to the Jonah syndrome. There's a better way. And that is what I would call bold love. Bold love will not wimp out, but it will not give in to the pressures of political correctness. It will not say what people want to hear just so we can all get along. But it will love nonetheless. I read a story about a minister who practiced that. He developed a burden for AIDS patients. He knew very little about homosexuality. In fact, as far as he knew, he didn't even know anyone that was homosexual. But he began going to the local hospital and he visited young gay men who was dying with AIDS. He was middle-aged, extremely conservative, but he tried to bridge the gap simply by being there. He wanted them to know that somebody cared. He prayed with them when they would allow it. He spent time with them and he showed them that he cared and he told them about Jesus. Well, as it would have it, the local gay radio program found out what he was doing and they called him up and they said, "Hey, we hear you're out there ministering to AIDS patients." "Well, yes, I'm trying." "Well, by the way, what's your position on homosexuality?" And he said, "Well, I believe it's a sin. I believe the Bible's clear on that." And they responded, "Well, we don't like that, but we do like your attitude. How would you like to come on our show and be a guest and discuss what it's like being a minister to helping AIDS patients?" And so he did. This middle-aged conservative minister found himself sitting across from a microphone of a gay host on a gay radio program. And at the end of the show, he gave the name and the location of the church he worked at. And wouldn't you know, sure enough, some openly homosexual people started coming to church. Not to repent, but just to hear this intelligent, compassionate man, what he had to say. And after a few weeks of that, some of the congregation got a little nervous. And finally, a group of them went to the minister, and they said, "Homosexuals are coming to our church. They're walking right down our aisles. They're sitting next to us in the pews. What are you going to do about that?" And the minister replied, "Well, I guess they can take a seat next to the idolaters, gossipers, and people who cheat on their income tax returns. You know, this church is a pretty big church. I think we have room for a few more sinners, don't you?" But from the pulpit, the minister was clear. He said, "We will not compromise biblical ethics. If you are here and you're involved in homosexuality, if you're involved in the use of pornography, or if you're involved in a sexual relationship outside of your marriage, the leadership here will not condone your behavior. We will not offer you a leadership position in the church, and we will not say that black is white. We are not going to compromise." But then he said, "If you are here and you're a lesbian woman or you're a gay man, we're so glad you're here. We hope you'll come back. We want to get to know you. But more important than that, we want you to know Jesus Christ, and we will do anything we can to enhance your knowledge of Him." That is bold love. Bold love seeks to serve without compromising. How then should we respond? We should respond by being a people that are compassionate, and I might add, compassionate without compromise. So, I think it's our duty today to search our own hearts. When we think about homosexual people, do you feel the grief of our heartbroken God when He said, "I take no pleasure in the death of the wicked"? Do you feel the righteous anger that comes from looking at sin and knowing what sin does to people? Or do we feel contempt, superiority, hostility? If we feel the latter, might we not today earnestly pray that God will replace that hostility with the love of Christ that will constrain us to love them without compromise? And if we respond effectively, we must rid ourselves of any hostility that may exist in our heart. Third point already. The church must repent of being intimidated by the gay rights movement and must recommit to her assigned role. This is where it gets good. And Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world." He wasn't making a suggestion. He wasn't even making a request. He was saying, "That's who you are. This is your assigned role." Salt in the church is there to preserve what is sacred. No wonder God so compels us to defend what the Bible teaches. And light? Light is there to illuminate. When we turned on these lights this morning in this church today, we didn't have a committee here to say, "Now, wait a minute, before we flip the light switch, we need to make sure that the light doesn't hit on anything that might offend anyone." No, light basically says, "Hello, I'm here, deal with it." That's its function. And you are the salt of the earth, and you are the light of the world. Dr. Martin Luther King said, "The church must be reminded that it is neither the master of the state nor the servant of the state, but the conscience of the state." You know what? A man without a conscience is one of the most scariest horror figures ever. He's a sociopath. If a sociopath is convinced that it's in his best interest to be nice to you, he'll be nice to you. If a sociopath feels it's in his best interest to kill you, goodbye. You're dead. It's all the same because he has no conscience. The only thing more frightening than a sociopathic man is a sociopathic culture. A culture whose conscience has been intimidated into silence will inevitably become a sociopathic culture. The gay rights movement has a twofold agenda. The twofold agenda is, first, they want to make homosexuality normal, and they're going to do that by redefining marriage and the family. And number two, they want to silence all opposing viewpoints. You know, the gay rights movement is intolerant of any other views. Now, I could share countless examples of this intolerant agenda of the gay rights movement. I'm going to share a few. In Colorado, a woman repented of lesbianism and she became a Christian. She had been involved in a relationship, and her and her lesbian partner had been raising an adopted daughter together. Now, after this woman became a Christian, she walked away from that relationship, and she and her former partner had to determine what to do with this little girl. The transformed woman was the legal primary caregiver, and yet she was told by the Colorado Family Court that she could not expose her daughter to any Christian material that might be discriminatory against homosexuality. In our neighbor, Canada, a bill was passed that now makes it illegal to state anything publicly that incites hatred toward homosexual people. Now, I'm certainly against inciting hatred against anybody. But what defines inciting hatred? Is it saying, we need to kill those homosexuals? Or is it calling them degrading names? Or is it quoting from the Bible? The bill doesn't say. Nobody is saying it yet. Perhaps they might ask the minister in Sweden who was arrested for violating a recently enacted Swedish bill that has made it illegal in Sweden to speak against homosexuality in public, including the pulpit. And what is especially chilling about this case are the words of the prosecuting attorney when he said, when he tried this case, collecting Bible verses on this topic constitutes hate speech. At this point, the majority of our fellow countrymen believe that homosexuality is immoral. And yet those willing to fight for that belief seem fewer and fewer. You know, it's one thing to hold a position. It is another to risk fighting for that position. Those of us who are willing to defend that position in public are getting smaller and smaller. We're a shrinking minority, and that's intimidating. Along with intimidation comes the temptation of appeasing or speaking what people want to hear, rather what they must hear. Appeasement is exactly what the British Parliament attempted to enact at the start of World War II when Hitler began to rise and go against Czechoslovakia. That's why Winston Churchill was so aggravated with them when the Parliament said this, Hitler is a tyrant. If we oppose him, we'll have to deal with him. Let's appease him and let him have Czechoslovakia so he'll leave us alone. Let's not make any waves. Churchill said prophetically to the British Parliament, you have been given the choice between war and dishonor. You have chosen dishonor. Now you'll have both. So let me be clear on this. If the body of Christ allows herself to be silenced on this issue, the body of Christ will have sent a message to our culture saying that anytime we say something that our culture deems offensive, we will give our culture permission to shut us up. And it will not stop at homosexuality. It will end only when we are no longer able to preach the gospel itself. And some of you are sitting there saying, oh, Tom, you went too far that time. Think about it. Is there anything more offensive than the cross? The cross is not a compliment. To tell our friends and fellow citizens that the only way they can be saved is by the sacrificial atonement of our Christ is telling them, you can't go to heaven on your own because none of us are good enough. That's not a compliment. And that's offensive to some people. If we allow ourselves to be silenced when we say anything offensive, we will ultimately lose our very ability to preach the gospel. And if we lose that, what on earth are we here for? How then should we respond? By being courageous. It's going to take godly courage to say plainly in the lunchrooms of our workplaces and in our schools and among our family members and friends when the subject of homosexuality comes up and when so many people say, yes, I think gay is a life choice. Yes, I think gay is okay. Yes, I think we should embrace it. It will take godly courage to say, you know what? I don't agree. I believe we have a creator. And I believe that creator loves us so deeply that he gave a very specific plan for our most intimate relationships. And anything short of that is not only a sin, but it is self-destruction. And with each coming year, as we say that, we will be speaking in the legacy of Martin Luther. Where at his heresy trial by the Catholic Church, he said, "My conscience is held captive by the Word of God. Here I stand. God help me. I can do nothing else." How then should we respond? Consistent, compassionate, but courage. You will need an increase in all three of these, because if we're going to be an effective voice, we're going to have to drown out so many who have the wrong message. So let me get to the point of the eldership. This is the message from them today. It's not full. There's going to be a lot of other questions. Maybe there will be more dialogue. But here it is. Can homosexual people attend Kimball Church of Christ? Yes. Will they be welcome here? Yes. Can they find friendships here? Yes. Can they find Jesus Christ here? Absolutely, yes. Will we open our doors to the gay community? Yes. Will we continue to teach what the Bible says? Yes. The local church must hold the line, both in the ways that homosexual behavior is always wrong, but complete deliverance is available at the foot of the cross.